Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's online satsang. And the topic today for our satsang is the soul's power of knowing God. But before we decide what is that soul power which knows God, how to find God, where is He? Where is He really? There is this story that the scriptures tell us about the musk deer. It secretes a kind of scent in a particular season. And then it goes crazy looking for it in the entire next few months and goes helter-skelter everywhere looking for the source of that scent. Everywhere in the forest, in the cliffs, in the crags, it goes and finally falls to his death, unfulfilled, still trying to look for that source of that mystical scent within him. It's exactly like that. The source, the God, is within us, isn't He? He's within us. Yogananda said, He is the nearest of the near. So how do we see Him? He's so near that sometimes we miss Him. How do we see Him when we want to see something? For example, this paper. If I want to read from here, if it's really near to me, can I really read it? No, I want to put it at a distance and then I want to read it. So the sense faculties, our sight, our ears, our taste, our smell, it is useless to find something which is so near to us, which is within us. We need another sixth sense organ to be able to help us find God within us. And this is the power of the soul. This is intuition. And intuition is the so all-knowing power of the soul. It does exactly what the sense organs do. It can see, it can feel, it can hear. When we hear from self-realized masters, their experience of finding God, they say, oh, God came in a flash of light. We heard a thunderous roar, right? But it does much more than the sense organs. Sense organs help us to relate to our physical realities, but intuition helps us to relate to infinity, to all the realities that exist in the world. And it is like the silent communication language between us and God and the gurus. It has no words, it's silent, but it's much more powerful than what words can convey to us, isn't it? Swami Kriyananda, when he had just come and joined Yogananji's ashram, in the beginning, he said that suddenly after a few weeks or some months, I found I was alone with my guru. And I said to myself, he probably thought that this is a great time to be able to clear up all my doubts, to be able to talk about the mysteries of the world, to know more about my spiritual path. And he started the conversation with Yogananji and he said, Master, how does Om sound? And Yogananji just did a prolonged and then he was silent again. Again, Kriyananji started. He said, how do we hear the sound of Om? And he just took the mudra, and after a few moments, again, he relapsed into silence. Then a few months later, Kriyananji told Yogananji, you know, Master, I'm not able to calm my breath in meditation very easily. So Yogananji said, that was because you used to talk too much earlier. So when Yogananji used to meet outside people, he would be at his charming, humorous best, and he would make them very comfortable. In fact, the people would come to his disciples and say, wow, what an amazing energy you are with throughout the day. But the disciples would only smile because they knew that when they were with Yogananji, his real disciples were around him, he would encourage only silence because he wanted them to commune with him, to attune with him, and then this is the soul communion between them. He always told them that I can help you more in your meditation from within. He was constantly communing with their souls. In fact, he knew more about them through this silent communication than what probably they knew about themselves. And he was always encouraging them, be open and receptive to me in meditation, tune into my consciousness. And why would we want to tune into Yogananji's consciousness? What does that even mean? When we talk about self-realized masters, Yogananji himself said that I killed Yogananda long back. Now, what exists in this temple is only God. So self-realized masters, their consciousness is not egoic. It is not limited to this physical reality of what they are. But it is merged with God. And when we tune to these great masters, to these gurus, they tune our consciousness into God. And this is the direct perception that we get of God, the direct knowing of God, which is the most important thing on any spiritual path. Also, through intuition, we can know the deeper realities of everything. When we commune with each other, when we commune with that inner power of the soul, we commune at the soul level. Don't we, when we go to a strange place sometimes, when we meet strangers, some people we find, you know, they have like, we say we have good vibes from this person. It feels as though we've known him for years. But there is no logic, no reason to that. Because we haven't known that person at all. And sometimes when we have this feeling of discomfort with a person, probably over lifetimes we have known these people. But our intellect, our reason, logic has forgotten that. But the soul still remembers and guides us. In the autobiography of a yogi, Master talks about Kashi, who was a student in his school in India, when he was in India. So they were just sitting around, he with his students, and he was just telling them things about the future. And suddenly for Kashi, it came out that you will be dead soon. Kashi was inconsolable and he said, you have to find me after I die. You have to get me back to you, to the spiritual path. And Yogananji, it was a big promise, but he did give that promise. And then after, soon enough, circumstances happened that Kashi did pass away. Then Yogananji started a search for Kashi, an intense search. And that search wasn't with his eyes and nose and ears. It was an intuitive search from within. And he got a signal after many months of looking, sending signals from his soul's power, from his soul's intuition. He sent a signal to Kashi. And he soon, after a few months, receives that signal. And he is directly able to reach the house where Kashi is to be reborn. And he goes and meets that family, tells them what kind of a person will be born to you, how will he look like. You know, and this is my student. And sure enough, exactly that happens. And the strangest thing was that Kashi, even as an infant, when Yogananji came and met him, Kashi showed a spontaneous, you know, recognition, a kind of love, affection for him. Because soul remembers, right? And this intuitive power that we have within us, it not only helps us to know God, but it's always gently pushing us, nudging us towards God. We all know that God is Sat Chit Anand, ever conscious, ever existing, ever new bliss. And that is my true self also, our true nature also. I've discovered that when I came here. But a lot of us may not even discover that. But still, intuitively, instinctively, we are always seeking that, which is the biggest fear that human beings have. The fear of death. We always want to exist, ever existing. We always want to be conscious. I remember when I was having my baby, I had to have a cesarean section. And everything was fine. I said, I'll take general anesthesia, so no problem, I won't feel anything. No big deal. But when they came with that mask to give me general anesthesia, there was a moment of panic. I just didn't want to go down. It was like a struggle. No, I don't want this. And when they put the mask, I was, inner panic was happening that I'm going to be unconscious soon. We are always moving towards full consciousness and bliss. We all know that. We are always moving towards happiness. Do we want to be sad? Do we want to be sorrowful? No. Why? Because our true nature is bliss, and that intuitive power knows and keeps guiding us towards it. Maybe we do it in the wrong way because we listen to our logic and reason. If I get so many BMWs and cars and houses, I'll be happy. But intuition knows, because when we reach the pinnacle of our success, pinnacle of our careers, we have heard of Shah Rukh Khan. He is the pinnacle, superstar in Indian cinema. He has everything at his command. What did he say? In an interview, he says, I have everything except a sense of fulfillment. What further do I need to do? Because when we reach that pinnacle of material success, happiness, I mean wealth, then we still realize there is something more. And then we go deeper into that soul, into that search. And intuition sends us there. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. And I will also share a few thoughts that Vasudha said. I hope that Shah Rukh Khan is watching this part, and then he will also have to take some actions now, if he has things that he has done. There is a particular story that I would like to share from the life of a great saint. I particularly enjoyed that movie about Joan of Arc. Joan of Arc used to also have a lot of visions and then visitations from different saints and angels when she was a teenage girl, in fact. And while we feel that it is a very blissful experience to have their visitations, their guidance was very, very difficult for her to follow at that time. What they wanted her to do, she was French, and at that time French was under attack by the English. And so these angels were giving her guidance that she needs to go and lead the French army, teenage girl. So while she was really having this good experience, she just had no courage, or she didn't even feel that she has a capacity to even follow that kind of a guidance. So many years she actually couldn't do anything on that. But finally she realized that dissatisfaction in her heart was just not bearable, and she just decides to act on it. And then finally, one thing leads to other, and there she is. She is leading the French army against the English. And one of the first battle, while she is also helping them lead to the best of her capacities, she gets wounded. Arrow hits her, and then they bring her back. And while she's recovering, she just dozes off for a moment, and then she wakes up, and then she sees the French soldiers returning. And for a moment she thinks France won. So she asks, did we win? She says, no, we had to retreat. Then she says, no, that is not what God wants. And then she rushes down, and then this council of all these big soldiers and then the captains and of the army, they are just discussing there. And then she said, like, what happened? Why are we retreating? This is not what we're supposed to do. Then they say, no, but John, we had a council and we decided that we need to retreat. Then she said, no, I also was in the council, and my council is far, far more superior than any human council. And they had complete faith in her, so they decided again to go back and then attack. And of course, at least in that battle, there was a victory. This is the same faculty that we is the topic of today's discussion, like the faith that she cultivated, which is comes from somewhere within herself. No, a teenage girl leading any army, it just doesn't make sense at all in any human conception or any kind of a mind, intellect, understanding. But it was the truth. It was supposed to be happen, because that was the reality, that firm faith that she had. And where did that come from? And that was the intuitive understanding of the soul, and that's what Vasudha was talking about. When Swami Kriyanandaji first came to master, he said he was very intellectual. And of course, it is not a wrong thing to be intellectual, absolutely. He had a very brilliant mind, and then he used that mind also later on to give a lot of expression to Master's teaching, and we are probably enjoying fruits of that effort ourselves as well. But the purpose for which Swamiji came to Master, he said, like, for that, that intellect is not enough at all. You need to develop devotion. Swamiji understood that. Again, that understanding comes more intuitive as well. And then he took it to heart, and then he chanted a lot. He spent a lot of time chanting, hours, he says, and he developed devotion. Those who of us, and even if you see his videos, which are towards the end of his lifetime, it's very difficult to even associate this story, as Swami tells, that he was once upon a time a very intellectual, where he can't even finish a sentence without actually crying or going into tears. This is the faculty that we talk about, intuition. And then many times when we talk about intuition or like having this divine guidance or something, you know, I'm sure every one of us has experience like that. But we talk about it as if like some once upon a time or once in a blue moon that is happens, and some things it's very sparkling is going to happen. As if like this is like one, and then what happens in between? Vasudha was talking about our essential nature, which is Satchidananda. Is it like one moment in our life that, yeah, that was the time when I felt I was Satchidananda? And then what? And that also, like when we talk about intuition, what is it that we are in tune with? And if we are in tune with life, that is what intuition is, isn't it? And what is the texture of life? Is life the way our minds understand these compartments? Is it like boxes? It is predictable in that the way our minds wants to predict. Is it possible to plan it from now till eternity? No, life's nature is spontaneity, isn't it? And one of the great saints that Master also talks about her in autobiography, Anand Moima. Her life was a very beautiful example of what actual life in its real essence is. She had a very, very spontaneous way of in her life. In a sense, like there was nothing planned. And then she would also use this beautiful word called khayal. And those of you know, understand Hindi, it has a very beautiful texture to that. And she would just be sitting, and then everything, maybe they're planning some events, and she would just call one of her devotees or her husband, who was also her devotee, and says like, I have this thought, or she would say, I have this khayal, that I need to go and visit this student of mine. And they says, Ma, this is not the best time. We are in the middle of this celebration and preparation. We can't go now. But she would say, just, no, we have to. And there, I think initially there were some resistances, but then in time they realized this is the nature, you know. The ma wasn't there to facilitate the convenience of the other people, but they were there to facilitate what ma wants, because she didn't necessarily was speaking something from her whims and fancies, but she was speaking from some space deep within. And of course, in time, what was the purpose gets revealed, and then the minds are there to chat, like, yeah, ma was right. But she never really objected. She never participated in any of these things. She felt it. She went for it. And that is the texture. That is the nature of life. Very spontaneous. The moment we try to box it, we try to sort of compartmentalize it, it sort of boxes out of it. It springs out of it. And who tries to do it? It's not that we intentionally do it, but this is the world we live in, mostly mind dominated. And that's why even like having access to these teachings is very beautiful. A life which is lived more from heart and than from mind. And not looking at living an intuitive life is like a once-in-a-lifetime phenomenon, or just in between those spurts of inspiration, like I sort of just go somewhere like that. No, when is the time when we feel God's presence the most? When is the time when we feel that guidance the most? You see, when life challenges us, isn't it? Most of the times when we hear from people their stories, they say, I was desperate. Nothing was making sense, nothing was helping me. And that's the time I prayed, and God answered. And then what happens? Then for temporarily it gets healed. We feel that, thank you, God. Now I can take forward from here till the next calamity hits, isn't it? But wisdom, as Master invites, no. Wisdom is understanding that wisdom, that understanding, that intelligence is always accessible. Not only always accessible, it is right here. And then the moment we put our faith in that, instead of our own mind and then all the projections that it always carries, we have the capacity to live a life which is intuitive and not just the moments of glances. As we speak now, we also understand there's a lot of confusion around us. There's a lot of, the world itself is going through many different things, and then this is a time for us also to introspect and reflect, and what is it? Where is it that we are going to put our focus on? Where is it that we have to find, and we will find, that stable ground? Is it, as Vasudha was talking about, is it going to be in some fame? Is it going to be in our bank balances? Is it going to be in some mansions around the Caribbeans? Is it going to be in our relatives or friends and families? All of this, possible, yes, we will do all of it, but the lasting stability. For us, when we say it is in life, for us it is the Guru who has basically has taken us into his in his aura. And so now it is our sort of a conviction, it is an invitation which I hope we will all accept with all our hearts, and keeping that heart open and then living in that presence. Because once we are onto that stable ground, the questions that we have the capacity to get answers, the confusion has the capacity to melt down. The clarity that we seek will come to us, and then the solace can be ours. So this is an invitation, and also this is a period that we can all strive together to find that stability in God, in our Gurus. Joy to you.